Okay. Welcome everyone to this session on end-to-end identity management. My name is Johann Nallathamby. I'm a technical lead in the WSO2 identity server product. So I think Shankar gave you a good overview of how IAM impacts digital transformation in enterprises these days. So my objective for this talk is to take you through a journey of how IAM requirements would come into an organization and how we would basically solve those requirements. So if you would be if you would be with me in this journey for the next 45 minutes, then I think you would be able to learn something about how identity server can help you solve those IAM requirements. So this is going to be the breakdown of my topic. So I have broken down the title. So I'm going to define three things. There's identity. I'm going to define identity. What do you mean by end-to-end? And what is it to manage identities, right? So there are many definitions for identity from many different fields of research. But ultimately, we can narrow it down to these four aspects, right? Who am I? What are my attributes? My age, my gender, my nationality, my language, so on and so forth. What are my behaviors? Why is my behavior important in identity management? Because think of it, for things like behavioral analytics or fraud detection, for things like that, we should learn something about the user's behaviors. And what are my relationships? Relationships with other identities, with applications, with identity providers, and devices when it comes to IoT. So these are the constituents of an identity. So it's important for a good identity management system to be able to manage these attributes of an identity. So then when we say end-to-end, we can look at it in two dimensions. End-to-end in terms of time. So if you take an identity, we should be able to manage its life cycle from the beginning to the end. If you take a user or if you take a group, right? These are identities. You should be able to manage the entire lifetime of that identity. And at any given point of time, you should be able to say, this is what has happened with this identity. This is what this identity has done. So that's end-to-end identity management in terms of time. And also we can say another dimension at a given snapshot of time with regard to your systems. So in a multi-level architecture, there are many accesses that are happening in your systems. So at each point of these systems, is your system very well secured, right? What is the security mechanism you are having? So it's not only at the perimeter, at every level, at the database level, at the internal network level, at your firewall level. So at every level, you should have good security prevention mechanisms. And then management, right? So I am an engineer, not a manager. So I can't give you a textbook definition of what is management, but I'm going to go through this journey and explain to you in terms of challenges and solutions, right? So I'm going to specifically look at the story of Bob, right? So let's look at Bob's workplace. So Bob is a senior engineer, right? He is working for a startup called X. He is actually responsible for the identity management of his staff. His company is a small company with a handful of employees. They have a very few applications. Bob's life was going good. So this is typically how a startup looks like, and not much of identity management in there. But slowly and steadily, we can see how identity management requirements come in, right? So Bob's company is doing very well, and they are expanding rapidly. There are new employees coming in, right? And they've started using new applications, some cloud applications as well. And identity management is becoming a headache for Bob, right? So Bob's scratching his head and thinking what to do. So the first problem he sees is, of course, multiple applications having multiple usernames and passwords, right? So how can we converge all these usernames and passwords and have a unified identity? So this is the first problem. So Bob's thinking, why not a centralized user directory, right? A centralized LDAP, right? So this is the idea that Bob has in mind. Connect all the applications to a centralized user store, right? Would that solve the problem? So Bob has some difficult questions in his head to be answered, right? How am I going to migrate all these users into the central directory, right? Am I sure there will be a few teams? I'm sure there will be a few teams who are not going to take this very well, okay? When it comes to migration, it's a pain, right? We see with a lot of our customers, there are a lot of teams. Each team has its own user store, user base, and migration, it doesn't really work. So as much as possible, try to integrate all those user stores and have a unified kind of directory rather than migrating everything to a centralized directory, because that's going to take ages and it never happens. And also another disadvantage of that is that each directory has its own advantage and advantage and disadvantage. So a JDBC user store might be efficient in let's say write intensive transactions. An LDAP user store might be efficient in read intensive transactions. So each user store has its own pros and cons and different reasons to choose. So you should not, if you choose on one directory, you lose out on the others. So it's better to have them coexist and do the job for you, right? And more importantly, does user directory solve all the problems that I have, right? We know user directories are stores, attribute stores, but does it also use information such as uniqueness of an attribute, temporality of an attribute, how often the attribute changes, is it permanent, is it like near permanent, is it always changing? What about the ownership of an attribute? Is it coming directly from the users, is the owner the user himself, or is he inheriting it from a group that he belongs to? And the trustworthiness of an attribute. Who is claiming that this attribute is the attribute of a user? I mean, the value is actually correct. Is it the user himself who is claiming it? Or is it a third party who is asserting it that this value is correct, right? So these kind of attributes are very important when you want to make identity management decisions. So just having a user directory alone will not help. And then we need to store and track user behavior for analytics and so on, like I said before. And then manage identity relationships, right? Manage relationships with applications, identity providers, devices, and other identities, and so on. You can link identities, you can merge identities, so on and so forth. So, and the biggest problem of them all is the user experience, right? So right now, in each application, Bob's users are logging in, they're typing their username and passwords again and again. Right? So that should not happen. They should have a good user experience. And also, the last but not least is username and password authentication secure enough? My applications are coupled with username and password authentication, right? So that's not secure enough. How can I decouple my applications from the way they authenticate, right? So if I list down those problems, but what Bob is having in his mind, these are the technical terms behind them. Identity integration. You need to integrate all your user stores together and provide a single unified identity to the applications, right? Brokered authentication. You don't want to embed your authentication logic into your application. You want to externalize your authentication to a different system, and that will handle the authentication for you, and that will manage the users in the user store. And that's the identity broker. And then single sign-on. When you have multiple applications, all the applications rely on the identity broker, and therefore, they should be able to get single sign-on. And then decouple authentication and the SSO protocol, right? So previously, Bob's applications was always doing username and password. But now what they can do is, if they are relying on a third-party identity broker, that identity broker can support many different forms of authentication. And the important feature is that if the identity broker wants to support a new authentication option, let's say biometric authentication, there should be no change on the application side. So those are the benefits that you get by providing identity broker kind of pattern. So Bob decides to set up an identity provider. So this is what we call an identity provider. Bob realizes that what he wants is an identity provider that provides identity integration, brokered authentication, single sign-on, and decoupling of the authentication method from SSO protocol. So this is why we need an identity provider. So in terms of identity server, we support many different protocols. Even Shankar's slides mentioned that. So one of the key improvements that we've done in the IS530 is that we are now completely compliant with the OpenID Connect protocol suite. So this is the complete OpenID Connect protocol suite. So with IS530, we support the entire suite here. Then there's another problem. The next problem that Bob faces is the authorization for the users, right? So currently, all the authorization logic is baked into his application, right? And the authorization rules are constantly changing, right? The businesses today are very agile. The policies are changing all the time. So your IT should be able to adapt these changes very quickly, right? So what he wants is to effectively govern his resources, govern any access to his resources, globally enforce access control policies, make the policy updates immediately effective, and also get a consolidated set of audit trails on who is doing what on what resources, right? So centralized policy administration, centralized policy enforcement, and centralized auditing of those accesses. So if we go into a little bit of theory, what is a resource access, right? So like in English grammar, like in a sentence, you get subject, object, and verb. Likewise, any resource access can be defined using these four attributes. So for any resource access, there is a subject, right? Who is accessing the resource? It can be a user or a group. What is the resource that is being accessed, right? That the protected resource. And what is the action that is being performed on the resource? And some additional contextual information, such as time, client IPs, et cetera, time of the day, day of the month, et cetera. So these four attributes can define a resource access. And then resources bring permissions to the system, right? So a permission is a resource plus an action. So if you do something on a resource, that's an action on the resource that gives you a permission. So users inherit permissions, and based on those permissions only, it is defined what resources they can access. So there are two kinds of authorization problems in the world. There are only two types of authorization problems in the world. One type is, as the first question indicates, is Alice allowed to update accounts, right? So the answer for that is a yes or a no, right? And the second type of problem is, what resources is Alice allowed to update? So the answer for that is a collection, right? So it can be a collection of resources, or the answer can be a collection of users, or the answer can be a collection of actions, right? So these are the two types of authorization problems that we have in the world. So Bob searches for some existing authorization models. So these are some very familiar authorization models that are coming from a long, long time. So you might know most of these. So access control matrices, role-based access control, which is still very prevalent in today's world, group-based access control, attribute-based access control, which is a little bit more fine-grained than role-based access control, ownership and sharing-based models. Like, for example, if you look at how Google Docs works, that's an ownership and sharing-based model, right? And then multi-level access control, where you have you give a classification level for a particular resource, and then a classification level for a particular user, and based on the classification levels, you basically decide whether the user can access the resource or not. So these are some traditional authorization models. But all of these models have some kind of limitations, right? So number one, the number of rules grow and become hard to manage, right? So with access control lists or with multi-level security models, the number of rules, when they grow, it's hard to manage. And not fine-grained enough. For example, role-based access control or group-based access control is not fine-grained enough, right? And hard to manage with constantly changing environments, right? So these are the limitations of well-known traditional authorization models. Right? So what's Bob thinking? So Bob is thinking, if my authorization logic can be centralized, right, externalized, not baked into my application, it's policy-based, it's declarative, I can change a policy, I don't need to write code, right? It's fine-grained enough and easy to manage, that's what I want, right? And we have that, and that's called Zachman. extensible access control markup language. So XACML is all that, centralized, policy-based, declarative, fine-grained, and easy to manage, right? And the identity server supports XACML 2.0 and 3.0. It can solve any authorization problem out there. And also, there is no alternative right now that we have for XACML. It can do very, very, very advanced authorization, solve very advanced authorization problems for you if it's used in the right way. And in fact, in IS 530, we've actually integrated the XACML engine in the middle of the authentication or the SSO flow to enforce some authorization policies. And if you have seen the IS 530, we've provided some templated authorization policies which you can use and modify and improve that and customize it to your business requirements. So that's there in IS 530. So we've looked at authentication, authorization, and auditing, right? So this is some trivia for you. It's called the golden standards of security because all of them starts with AU, which is the prefix for the symbol of gold. Right, so the next problem Bob is facing is I'm still provisioning all new accounts manually to my identity broker, right? As well as each and every cloud applications. Remember, he has some cloud applications as well. So although they support federated authentication with our identity broker, they still need to be mapped. They need a mapped account in the cloud. So he needs to automate this. So every time there's a new user that's coming in, he needs to manually provision these users in the cloud and then map it, right? So how can he automate this, right? So that's where outbound provisioning comes in. So this is another feature of the identity server, right? So outbound provisioning, so you can basically configure external third-party systems to the identity server and say that whenever a user gets provisioned or deprovisioned or updated in the identity server, those changes must be reflected in the external system. So this way, the management is centralized in the identity server, and the external systems are automatically taken care of. The external systems can be on-premise or cloud systems. Then also, Bob now wants to go a step further, right? Now he wants to be able to decentralize control and empower his users to govern their identities within a confined kind of a framework, right? So he wants to basically give self-service to the users, right? He wants to make life much easier for his users. So these are some of the features in the identity server that allows you to do self-servicing, right? So this is a screenshot of the IS 530. So self-sign-up, so there are some new features related to self-sign-up. So you can see at the bottom there is Google ReCAPTCHA integrated with IS 530. Then workflows. So whenever you do a self-sign-up, you don't want your users to automatically go and log into the system, right? That you don't want that to happen. So ideally, what you want to happen is whenever a user account gets created, you want to trigger a workflow, right? And then there is a multi-level approval that goes on, and then finally you send an email to the user, and then he verifies his email address, updates his password, and then gets to log in. So there needs to be an approval process. So that's what is meant by workflows. So in identity server, basically you can have a multi-level approval workflow, and in each level you can have multiple options, right? Multi-level, multi-option, very similar to the authentication flow that we have, multi-level, multi-option. And in each option, it can be a user or it can be a role that you specify. Whoever user who belongs to that role can come and approve. So a little bit about the architecture of the workflow component. So the workflow component that ships with identity server actually works with the WSO2 business process server. So that's the out of the box BPS support that we provide. But in fact, the architecture is such that you can plug in the workflow component to a different BPS engine if you have one in your organization. So there are certain extension points in the system which will allow you to integrate IS with a different BPS engine. So the executor and the initializer, those are the components that actually do the workflow execution part, so you can extend that. As well as on this side, these are the workflow triggering points. So what we have in IS530 is trigger workflows for any user management operations, any role management operations, any credential management operations. So for those operations, you can trigger workflows. But if you want to trigger workflows for additional operations, like create a service provider, publish a ZACMAL policy for any of that kind of operations, you can basically write one of these event handlers and use the workflow component. So this is basically the architecture of the workflow. And then again, coming back to self-service, we have account recovery. So you can recover your username, you can recover your password based on emails or challenge questions. So these are all self-service capabilities. Yeah. So there are a few slides, I think, that's getting skipped. OK. So the other capabilities related to the slide that was missing is identity governance and administration. So there are several features that we have related to identity governance and administration. And especially, there has been a lot of effort that we put in the IS530 release related to identity governance and administration. So there is account disabling, account locking, mitigation of brute force attacks. So mitigation of brute force attacks by, like, let's say the user enters invalid password 3 times, then you show a captcha. The user enters invalid password 5 times, then you basically lock the account, right? So those are mitigation measures that we have. Then we have something called admin-initiated password request. So in certain cases, you need to call up to a support person and say, please trigger a password reset request for me. So that feature is also there in IS530. And then password history. Basically, you can say that user should not be able to update his password to the same password he has in his previous 5 attempts. Or last 5 passwords he can't use again. So that's password history. Then we have idle account locking. So if the account has not been used for login for about 6 months, let's say, send some reminders and then lock the account if he doesn't respond, right? Then password expiry. If the password hasn't been updated for, let's say, 6 months or 1 year or whatever specified time, send reminders and lock the user out until he changes his password. So those are some of the features that we have in IS530, which fall under the identity governance and administration area. And then analytics. So analytics, like Shankar mentioned in his talk, is a key area. For a long time, that has been lacking in IS. But with IS520, we actually introduced analytics, and we've improved it in IS530. So basically, it's powered by the WSO2 data analytics server. So we are internally using Siddhi for the real-time processing. And also, we have batch processing with Spark. So these two engines actually process the data, and then we have some dashboards that show you the visual data, and also we can download some reports. So these are some dashboards that we have. So basically, you can see, so in IS520, we introduce authentication analytics. So this shows you all the login attempts, the success and the failure. Then you can filter it out by service providers, identity providers, users, roles, first factor, second factor, so you can filter it out by them. You can search by date. Then you also have a table of all the raw data. So these are the features that we have related to analytics. And in IS530, what we've added is the alerts. So we have alerts for suspicious logins and abnormally long sessions. So basically, if the session is abnormally long compared to the user's general average, then we send some alerts. So all right. So Bob has a top-notch identity management system running in his organization with all the identity governance and administration, single sign-on, authorization, everything, right? So Bob is now being promoted as an identity architect in the organization, right? He is very happy. Life is going good. So after some time, now Bob's company acquires a company called Vi, right? And Bob's CTO tells Bob that those new employees will need to have access to to their applications and wants him to see how best they can manage access from those other employees to the existing applications. So things are not looking good for Bob now, right? Because why? Bi has its own identity and access management system just like X, right? It's different. And the system is connected to their corporate user directory. They have a security architect who says, I'm not going to expose that corporate directory outside the firewall, right? You have to come in some other way. And Bob doesn't want to be going and changing all the applications to support this new identity provider, right? So these are the problems Bob is having. And Bob then learns about identity federation, right? So this is the problem statement. So users will use application across enterprise borders and in the cloud, right? So the solution for that is set up multiple trust domains. Where in each trust domain, there is an identity provider, and the trust is established between the identity providers. So the application don't know about all the identity providers. They always talk to their identity provider, and the identity providers know who the other federation parties are. And the identity providers know to federate between themselves. So it's based on trust relationship. So this will actually solve Bob's problem. So Bob has an identity provider in his company X. The new company Y has an identity provider. So he can set up X and Y to be in a federation, in a trust relationship, right? So seamlessly, the new users in Y also can access applications in X. So Bob goes into a meeting with security architect of Y, right? And he thinks this is a done deal, right? But he comes to know in the meeting that their identity provider doesn't support XAML, doesn't support OpenID Connect, but it supports XAML, right? Now Bob is very furious, right? All our applications here work with OpenID Connect, which is the latest standard. And who would not support OpenID Connect? And what is this XAML? And also, they are not using standard claim dialects or claim URIs. They are using some custom claim URI. So claim URI is basically how you identify a particular attribute of the user. So there should be an identifier for email. There should be a unique identifier for the age. So these identifiers should be understood between the application and the identity provider, right? So those are claim URIs. So there are some standard claim URIs, and there can be custom claim URIs. So these are the problems. So Bob is facing. So XAML doesn't specify a standard claim dialect, whereas OpenID Connect specifies a standard claim dialect. So this is called the problem of federation silos, right? So we have not yet realized the world where there's one good federation protocol and everyone is using that. There are still a lot of federation protocols coexisting, and we need to federate between each other. Right, so federation silos are still there. So how can we solve that, right? So that is where the identity bus comes into the picture, right? So these are the key objectives of the design of the identity bus, which we introduced way back with identity server 5.0. So these are the key benefits of identity bus. So number one is identity hub. So identity server can function as an identity hub. So what do you mean by an identity hub? It sits centrally and it connects to service providers and identity providers, right? So the service providers don't know about the identity providers. The identity providers don't know about the service providers. It's very easy to manage. It's easy to remove a link and it's easy to add a link. So the management is done centrally, and the service providers and identity providers don't know about each other. So this makes it easy. It's like a hub and spoke model, right? Then identity bridging, right? So service providers may talk XAML SSO, identity providers may talk OpenID Connect, or vice versa. So we need to translate between the protocols. So that is why we need identity bridging, right? And then the claim transformation. So like in Bob's case, he's using OpenID Connect in his applications, which have a standard claim dialect, whereas the identity provider in company Y uses a different custom claim dialect. So he needs to do some mapping. So that's claim transformation. And similarly, we have role transformation. So roles are also specific to applications, specific to an organization. So you need to be able to map, convert the role definitions to different names so that it makes sense for the other organization. So there needs to be role transformation. So these are some of the key benefits of an identity bus. So yes, with identity bus, he can solve the problem of authentication using federation, right? But hold on. There is the problem of authorization, right? Our authorization is entirely centralized in our identity provider, in X. Applications talk with our identity provider for authorization. Wise IAM couldn't even support OpenID Connect. There is no way they are going to support Zachmer, right? So what am I going to do, right? And also, I need to provision those users to my cloud applications because they need to access my cloud applications as well. So these are some problems. So for that also, we have solutions. That's called just-in-time provisioning, right? So just-in-time provisioning means when a new user comes from a federated identity provider, trusted identity provider, to your identity provider for the first time, you provision that user just in time into the local directory, or you can provision him outside to a federated, to a cloud application, or to a different application. So that's called just-in-time provisioning. The very first time he comes into your identity provider, bringing in a social identity or an identity from another enterprise directory, you can basically identify the claims, identify his unique user ID, and then provision him based on that. So that is just-in-time provisioning. So outbound just-in-time provisioning means from the identity server, you provision him outside to a cloud application or a on-premise application. So it can, the just-in-time provisioning can be to your local user directory, or it can be to a different system as well, like Salesforce or Google or whatever. And then provisioning bridge. So we talked about the authentication bridge, where you can talk with SAML and then bridge it to OpenID Connect or vice versa. Likewise, provisioning also can be bridged. So you can provision users with SCIM or SOAP, and also you can bridge it to, let's say, Salesforce, Google, or SPML, another standard. So these are all different APIs or protocols which you can bridge between. So provisioning also we can bridge. Right, so Bob's problem was solved to a certain extent, and he was saved by the bus, right? Narrow shave, okay. So I talked about bridging, and I talked about this provisioning bridging and authentication bridging, which brings me to this concept of connectors. So because we have bridging, we can basically write and plug in connectors, and you can enhance the number of protocols that we can bridge between. So if you go to store.wso2.com, you can find a large number of connectors for the identity server. So we have connectors for authentication, first factor, second factor, third factor authentication. We have connectors for provisioning, and we have some connectors for OAuth grant types, if you know what that means. And so there are several connectors. So a lot of connectors are available in the public store, apart from what we ship out of the box. So some more time goes, and Bob CTO calls him and says, we've decided to expose our internal applications as services for our clients to consume, right? And find out how we can expose them securely, right? So Bob was expecting this, actually. It can't be any surprise, because these days, APIs is like bread and butter, right? It generates a lot of revenue for the company, so Bob was expecting this. And he had already done his research. He knows how to secure APIs, and that's no surprise. Again, OAuth 2, right? So it's delegated access control with OAuth 2, right? So people sometimes get it wrong. OAuth is not an authentication protocol. OAuth is not an authorization protocol per se, but it's a delegation protocol. So it's delegated authentication as well as authorization. We can call it delegated access control with OAuth 2. So some more time goes. So with regard to OAuth 2, identity server, again, like OpenID Connect, supports all the specifications and all the extension specifications related to OAuth 2, like introspection, dynamic client registration, so on and so forth. So all those specifications, especially with IS 530, we are kind of complete in terms of specification related to OAuth 2 and OpenID Connect. So some more time goes by, and then Bob CTO again comes and says, we need to consume some of our partner services and expose it through our gateway, right? However, it is secured. This partner service is secured with some kind of a token, which he doesn't know about. He's the CEO, so he doesn't care. So Bob needs to dig into the details and find out what this token is all about, right? So this is called a subsystem, a trusted subsystem pattern. So basically, you have an API gateway, let's say web service 1, that's the API gateway of X, and then their partner's gateway is web service 2. So basically, you're consuming your partner's API and exposing it outside. So this is called a trusted subsystem pattern, right? So what's important in this pattern is that the downstream service, web service 2, needs to know about the identity of the actual user who is using, who is carrying out this transaction, right? And how does it get to know, right? There are a couple of ways that it can get to know. So remember, web service 2 needs to know about the actual identity of the user behind this computer. So that's called identity flows. So there are a couple of ways that can be done. The simplest way is basically trusted subsystem generated identity tokens, right? Which means web service 1 can basically generate some kind of a token by itself and send it to web service 2. And basically web service 2 will blindly trust web service 1. And web service 1 will say, this is the user, trust me, do whatever your process based on this user. It can be writing to an audit log, writing to some database, updating some records, something like that. So that is basically trusted subsystem generated identity tokens. Then there can be third-party generated identity tokens, right? So in that case, web service 1 would talk to a third-party system, like a STS, right? A resource STS, a security token service, and get a token, and then send it to web service 2. So this way, web service 2 doesn't directly trust web service 1, but it trusts a third party. And likewise, there can be many services that trust the third party. So the services themselves don't need to trust each other. They can all trust the third party. So it becomes easy to manage. Then another way of sending the identifier is using user self-signed token. So basically, the client here itself would generate a signed token which is verifiable and send it to Web Service 1. Web Service 1 would in turn create another token by embedding this token and send it to Web Service 2. So Web Service 2 can basically identify both tokens, and he can verify both tokens individually, and he can verify the user, and also he can verify Web Service 1. So both he can verify individually. So that's even more better. And of course, then there is identity and credential mapping. So basically, you map the identity. So for each identity that is coming from this business application, you map to a different identity who is actually understood by Web Service 2 and do the transaction. So there is a mapping always. So that's also one way of doing trusted subsystem patterns. So out of these patterns, for Bob's case, he uses JWT grant profile for OAuth 2. So that basically falls under user self-signed tokens. The client application box here is actually the web service 1. That is the gateway, the Bob's gateway. And then there is some resource in company Y or the partner company, and identity provider is Bob's identity provider. So Bob gets a token, a JW token from his identity provider, because Bob's applications use OpenID Connect. So they get a JWT token, and they send it to the authorization server in the partner company. And then they would get an access token from the partner company. Right? So the partner company's authorization server, OAuth 2 authorization server, should trust the identity provider. Right? So he knows how to trust, and he knows how to verify the JWT. So by verifying the JWT, he would send back an access token to the client application, and then the client application would do the API call with that access token. So this has been the successful journey of Bob in his enterprise, right? So these are the things he has used as tools to solve his problems, right? We looked at the identity provider pattern. We looked at four major problems that identity provider solves, right? So it solves identity integration, single sign-on, I can't remember the all four, but yeah, it solves four problems, right? So, and then centralized authorization and auditing we looked at. Outbound provisioning, how Bob was able to automatically provision those users to the cloud application, right? Self-service and account and password control policies, I talked about what are the features we have in IS530. Workflows, analytics, we have authentication analytics, session analytics, and real-time alerting for suspicious logins and long sessions. Identity federation, we saw how when company Y came into the picture, how Bob was able to allow company Y's employees to access his applications. And then just-in-time provisioning, how Bob was able to just-in-time provision those company Y users to the cloud applications and his internal user directory. And then delegated access control, how Bob's data was, he was able to expose it securely to the outside through an API gateway and protect it using OAuth2, and then how he used trusted subsystem to expose one of his partner gateways through his gateway by using the trusted subsystem pattern and using JWT grant profile. So like JWT grant profile, we also have SAML2 grant profile, so that is also supported in the identity server. So in all of these, what we see is that if you would have been there for yesterday, Sanjeev's keynote, there are three key important points in a digital transformation era, right? So one is leveraging on new business models, right? User experience, improving, keep on improving, keep up with the user experience, and optimize your operations, right? So if you look at all these points have impact on those three aspects, right? So that's Bob's journey, and I think you've got a clear idea of how IAM problems come into an organization and how a product like Identity Server can solve those problems step by step, by catering to your custom requirements also, and solve your problems. So, yeah, thank you.